would say, I would love to take a photograph of you. You know, there's something so beautiful about the way you are standing, you know, just don't do anything, just stand there and I'll take it very quickly. And they would let me do that, you know. And I would do it quickly so that they wouldn't pose, you know, they wouldn't arrange their hair or something. When you know you have an audience, you put on an image that's a little bit not you, but the way you want people to see you.
Immigrants have moved to the Lower East Side since as early as the 1830s or 40s, but it really became the Jewish Lower East Side after the 1880s and 90s. That's when it really was at its peak. It was the densest neighborhood in the world. It was, I think, denser than Bombay. Rebecca Lepkoff is born in 1916, and she's the second of six children, and her parents are in some ways very typical Russian Jewish immigrants. Her mother, and this was not atypical, her mother comes to the Lower East Side and hates it.
She used to bemoan the fact that Christopher Columbus discovered America. Because she said, for her, that country wasn't so good. After a certain amount of time, she just couldn't cope anymore, and she just left reality, you know. She just had a nervous breakdown, and she was very gentle, but she wasn't there for us.
Immigrants continued, you know, to stream in from mostly from southern Italy and from Eastern Europe. And then in 1924, when the immigration restriction laws were enacted, the numbers really started to fall off. And between 1920 and 1930, the Lower East Side lost something like 40% of its population. As the first generation of immigrants started to make more money, they would move out of the neighborhood as soon as they could. Social workers, settlement workers, social theorists, their perception is that after 1924, that the people who are left on the Lower East Side are either deviant, they're criminal, that it was a neighborhood of people who couldn't make it out. The year is 1939, and Rebecca has a camera in her hand. And she just literally takes it out on the street and starts photographing her own neighborhood.
I decided I'll take the pushcarts on Hester Street. I thought that the pushcarts were doing a great job. You know, the fact that they were independent, they didn't want to work in a factory. The women going shopping, you know, and preparing the food. Walking down Madison Street, where there were little stores, there was a store that was a meat store, there was a store that was a shoe store. With that shoemaker in there fixing shoes, the guy with the meat sitting there with the sausages hanging down. One man sitting outside the store with the chair tipped back, you know, just relaxing. And I said, listen, the guy looks so nice.
Those are images that are very at odds with what people were thinking about the Lower East Side during the 30s. She doesn't see a passing community. She doesn't bemoan a dying community. She sees life on the Lower East Side. The most famous photography of the Lower East Side is Jacob Riis. And Jacob Riis has a social agenda. He's trying to ameliorate conditions on the Lower East Side. And so he basically shows the Lower East Side in its worst light. He actually crops the pictures so that they look more menacing. Everybody looks kind of crazy or almost criminal. Rebecca is doing something very different.
This was at 343 Cherry Street, where I lived in a cold water flat with my husband. They lived down on the basement floor. Her name was Mrs. Taylor, and it was a mystery how they managed to subsist. I don't know who worked or how the money came in. Look at this sweet face that she has, you know, this gentle creature, and her petting the cat that looks so content. And there she is hugging her grandma. a very nice family, very gentle, sweet family. How could you say be miserable when all that was happening?
In 1962, her husband convinced her to move to Teaneck, New Jersey. And I don't think that she was too happy about that, because as soon as her daughter was ready to go to college, she convinced him to move back to the city, and they moved back in 1979, and they've been here ever since.
The suburbs is really a bastard place. I mean, this is terrible to say that. You leave the richness of civilization, that's what I think, of people living together and their products and their habits and their superstitions and their craziness and all their differences and sameness. You leave it and you come to a desert of nothingness. I mean, people in the suburbs are gonna hate me for this.
In the 50s and the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, she continued to shoot photographs of kids who she's always loved photographing. And whether they're Chinese or Jewish or Puerto Rican or Black, she still sees the same continuity, the same, it's the kids, they're just playing different games. Sometimes they're playing the same games.
The photograph that had selling lulavs on Canal Street, a man came forth and said, "That's my father." And he looked just like his father. Another event was a young girl came over and said, "That's my grandmother." This was this very old woman, this photograph of this ancient, beautiful-looking woman, you know. Well, it's like an ongoing thing. The next generation is there alive and seeing their father or their grandmother as they were. It's like bringing up the past to the present. So it's exciting. When I think of how the streets were then, and I walk, when I walk, I see all the places that it used to be. I don't know if I long to be back then. I wouldn't want to go back and live then and go through all the things I went through since. I do enjoy looking at those photographs.